Thank you very much, Timo, and thank you for inviting me here to come to Helsinki again. I was here a few times before. And let me start with one remark. Also, something what I have been working on and worrying about is the concept of filter bubbles. So people know what filter bubbles mean. So basically what it means that if you personalize information, we live in our own world. And the internet has promoted certain techniques that this gets further in hand. So why I mention this is I come from America, I come here to Helsinki, and I'm sure I live in some ways in a filter bubble determined that I live in the United States, not Finland. So having said this, I would like to encourage you to interrupt me at any point of time if I say not understand, or if you have comments where you hear what I say wrong. So let's keep this. This is still a pretty small audience. As interactive as possible. We don't have to wait till after the talk. So please ask me any questions. So before sort of I get into the topic, and Ari asked me last night, well, what do I really do? And I said, well, some of the things here have determined my research efforts for a long time. And as Timo mentioned, we have a Center for Lifelong Learning and Design. So what I consider fundamental design challenges is, how do we create environment where people don't have the feeling they have to learn, but they want to learn? So assuming most of you came to this presentation or to this gathering voluntarily, so there is probably a certain want to, whereas many students feel if they go to class, they have to go. And I mean, it's well known that if people want to do something, they succeed much more, they show more engagement than if they have to do something. Then the second aspect, what interested us for a long time, is the attribute of someone being a teacher in a learning a function of a person, as we conceptualize learning environments. And I think to a very large extent, this is what we have done. And the question is, what would it mean that we reconceptualize this, at least in certain settings, that it is a function of a context? So last night when we talked about this, I said, if I come to Helsinki, all of you would be my teacher. If you would come and visit me in Boulder, I probably would be the teacher. If I talk to my graduate students about the latest trick in social media, they are clearly my teacher. I hope there are other areas where I can remain their teachers. And so the question is, what do we gain by thinking a little bit about the two points on the right-hand side? Another thing is, because lots of people thinking about learning and education, are very much focused on schools and universities and the concept of courses. And the main argument is that these entities are not God-given entities or made by nature, so we cannot change them. But they are social constructs. And so as our world changes, maybe these institutions should also change. Schools taught a lot of facts, for example, and any fact, like, you know when Aalto died? Anyone knows? So I had this conversation.
Now we talk about Alvar Aalto, not the university.
Yeah, yeah. So we had this little conversation with Timo 15 minutes ago walking around, and he didn't know, but he had his little smartphone, and so within a minute he could tell me when he died. And so these are things which, you know, a generation ago all did not exist. And so maybe, just as I will not explore this idea further, maybe schools should not emphasize the teaching of facts so much, because we can learn facts on demand as we need them. And the last point is a little bit related to the differentiation between learning and education. And the slogan there is that teaching and learning are not inherently linked. There is a lot of learning without teaching. And I think the opportunities for learners have greatly increased. But in the other way, and I tell this myself, being a teacher, there is a lot of teaching without learning. And what's the purpose of me teaching a course if the students don't learn something? So this is sort of very broad background. But what I want to do in this presentation, to talk a little bit more specific about massive open online courses, MOOCs. Now, if you look at the question, what made MOOCs popular, there were primarily technology perspectives and economic perspectives. The economic perspectives related to scalability. Some MOOCs had over 100,000 participants, productivity, and also being free. I don't know exactly the situation in Finland, but you may know that in the United States, to go to a university is quite a costly affair. So suddenly someone comes along and says, well, if you take a MOOC, it's for free. In the technology perspectives, where questions, how can we support very large number of students for maybe the delivery part of a MOOCs, maybe even other questions as MOOCs came along, where how do we support automated grading? How do we support peer-to-peer learning? So let's say someone in Stanford gives a course about artificial intelligence, and the system finds out that there are 30 participants in Helsinki. So how could we facilitate that the 30 students in Helsinki get physically together from time to time and talk about this course, and is there a value added doing so? What we were really interested was to create an understanding of MOOCs from a learning science perspective, and understanding how MOOCs could not necessarily replace universities, but how they could complement other approaches. And still another focus of what I will say in my presentation is not only internal aspects of MOOCs, but also external views. So these are sort of internal views, or what I consider internal views of MOOCs. Anyone knows, has heard the differentiation between ex-MOOCs and C-MOOCs? So basically, ex-MOOCs are the ones which really became popular, and they are much more sort of a teacher-centered approach. C-MOOCs have more interaction capabilities. They're more reflecting on collaborative knowledge construction. So what the exact differences are, if this is of interest to you, maybe you can pursue this a little bit. The comments which I will make, because what really most people understand by MOOCs are related to ex-MOOCs. And so keep this in mind, what I say in the rest of the lecture is primarily focused on ex-MOOCs. So this notion of free, which I will elaborate a little bit later on, is the new model is that they provide basic services for free. That means you can listen to the lecture. And then they have premium services, like you get a certification and you usually pay for this. So one of the issues is what is the sort of economic foundations of MOOCs, and they may want to make money by introducing these premium services. It's not an unknown concept. Many software products on the web, you get a basic service for free, but then if you want to have specific features, you pay for premium services. Then as people look at MOOCs, they collect data on number of participants, educational background of participants, completion rates, assessment and certification. Is it done automatically? Is it done from peers? Do the MOOCs people hire a large number of human tutors who can do some of the assessment? Learning analytics and big data was really promoted by MOOCs. And the simple reason for that is that the interaction, if people participate in a MOOC, is inside a computational environment. And thereby, you, the people, could collect immense data about these interactions, which provided then foundations for learning analytics. I mentioned already local meetup groups, and then a newer thing, particular promoted by one of the big American MOOCs types company called Udacity, are nano degree programs. So these are some aspects which one all, and I will say a little bit more about some of them, one can discuss, and I characterized them as internal aspects of MOOCs. So what would be external aspects? Well, how does it relate to lifelong learning? Are MOOCs more popular in that people work in industry and continue their learning process throughout their life? I know that some people of you are thinking about blended learning. To which extent do they support collaborative learning? Then another way of thinking about learning is it mostly conducted as a push activity? So someone pushes information on you, or is it a pull activity? You want to learn something, you learn something on demand, and we can distinguish what are the trade-offs between these two things. Then curriculum versus self-directed learning. A lot of learning is conducted in a curriculum style that someone determines, yeah, if you want to learn something about topic X, here are the important parts of it. Whereas many people, maybe if they fall into this want-to-learn category, is self-directed learning. Then there is this distinction between formal and informal learning. And I will say a little bit more about these two concepts of learning about versus learning to be, and learning when the answer is known versus learning when the answer is not known. Do I hold my microphone close enough that you can hear in the back, or are there problems? No problems? Closer or like this? Okay. So one question which we also try to explore we had this concept of gift wrapping, and what it means, if you develop something, you basically do not change what you have, but you use nice gift wrapping paper to make it look better. And so if we apply this to the MOOC enterprise, there was this concept of MOOCifying, which meant someone taught a class at a university, and so he said, oh, now I can approach thousands of people, so I just take my class and MOOCify it with no reflection on, does this also require that you may change the content, the interrelationship, exploit to different techniques. Peter Drucker has this nice quote, there is nothing so useless as doing efficiently that which should not be done at all. So is that a potential criticism of MOOCs? Now, the other thing is, how do we conceptualize MOOCs? Mostly they are conceptualized as courses conducted online, but maybe we should think about MOOCs being the textbook of the 21st century. Or, again, just out of curiosity, who has heard the concept of flipped classroom? So quite a few of you also. So can MOOCs be used to support flipped classrooms arrangements? So our thinking was, from this learning science perspective which I postulated, how could we move from gift wrapping to what we labeled co-evolutions? And another slogan which we used is that distance learning is or should be different from classroom learning at a distance. Gift wrapping is a tricky issue, and there you can study historical events like when film came along first. It started off of being filmed theater. When film first started, people didn't understand that there were fewer constraints if you had film than what you had in theater, and it took quite some time to develop new ideas what how film could transcend filming theater. And me, in my own activities, I was really not interested to teach a MOOC, but I was interested in what is the value added which I could provide as a teacher, lecturer in a university which MOOCs couldn't provide, from a perspective that they would complement each other rather than replace each other. So this is a model which we developed to kind of illustrate this notion of co-evolution, that we have new media and new technology like MOOCs, but we should also think about learning, working in collaboration, and how it would change in a co-evolutionary fashion with new media and new technologies. And obviously, we also would have new learning organizations. People wouldn't necessarily come to physical universities. So Limus said that I was involved in thinking what could computers mean and how could they facilitate new forms of learning from my very young ages. And so back in the 1970s, there were two basic paradigms which people articulated. One was to basically say, oh, the computer can teach the learner. And it went back psychologically to Skinner, who was a very famous psychologist and could be labeled as instructionism. On the other side, there were educational theories going back to Piaget, which were labeled constructionism, and where people played a much more active role creating something. Now, these theories led first to programmed instruction, which was done in part in the very early days on paper, and then it led to computer-assisted instruction, and then later on to intelligent tutoring systems. And in the United States, there were particular places which emphasized this approach. And I would say ex-MOOCs, which is sort of the topic, clearly fall into this category. And if you look at it from learning science perspectives, critical issues were coverage, coherence, personalization via user models. On the other side, and my personal involvement was on the right side, instead of the computer being the teachers, metaphorically speaking, we believe that the student teaches the computer via programming. And as you program something and your program doesn't work, you reflect on your own thinking. Maybe you get help from a human tutor in these efforts. And the critical concept, which gained a lot of popularity in the US over the last few years, is computational thinking. And one of my mentors was Seymour Papert, who was postulating these ideas again starting in the early 1970s. And people looked into interactive learning environments. So again, a test, who has ever heard from what Scratch is? Who has ever heard the concept? So quite a few people. I mean, the filter bubbles are not as closed that we not share some joint concepts. And one issue early on from this approach was digital literacy. So we wrote papers about independence of high-tech scribes. So with printed literacy in the Middle Ages, if you had a smart idea but you couldn't read and write, you had to go to a monk and say, could you write down this for me? Or could you read something to me? And our societies make incredible efforts to make sure that printed literacy is something which all of our students will obtain. Now, digital literacy is basically the analogy to this is, if I want to express something with the help of a computational environment, can I do this myself? Or do I have to go to a high-tech scribe, like the people in the Middle Age had to go to a scribe? And so many of these interactive learning environments were shaped to kind of make or build fewer demands that digital literacy could be a realistic goal. And the learning science topics were so learning by doing, self-directed learning, problem-based learning. While I explain this now as two totally disjoint activities, there were also numerous attempts to find out how could they complement each other rather than you say, oh, I believe in one aspect or the other. So MOOCs, even say, sort of became, I would say, popular in the worldwide context in 2011, when two people in Stanford taught an AI course where 160,000 people signed up for. So where some earlier attempts, like MIT had a very famous open courseware initiative. So open universities were maybe the most famous ones in England, but also the Netherlands. I don't know whether Finland has an open university, could also be considered as forerunners of those. Then the connectionist MOOCs, which I mentioned earlier, Weil sort of started the thinking about in 2008, and then 2011 was this first ex-MOOC with this huge number of people signing up for it. And then companies developed, like, again, here is my American background. Some of the major companies today are MIT edX, or it's actually, this is how it started, but now MIT, Harvard, and Berkeley are together in edX, Coursera, Udacity, and FutureLearn is a European effort in Great Britain, which used the ex-MOOC ideas and mostly developed in the context of the Open University. Out of curiosity, is there sort of, this is US, this is British, Germany also has an effort. Is there a particular Finnish effort in creating a company along these lines? Yeah. So, out of, go ahead. His question. So the question is, if we look at this slide, why, if this effort goes go back 10, 15, 20 years, maybe even into the 70s, why did SOE not succeed, and what is really new now with MOOCs coming along? Is that a fair summary state? Well, I think that there are a number of components. One is that modern technologies support the reach, people who you can reach in much easier fashion. I mean, in the old days, the Open University sent printed material to its participants, and then the participants sent this printed material back. Whereas if I offer a MOOC and someone anywhere in the world has an internet connection, they can participate, sign up for it. So it was a much more organized effort in the old days based on the limitations of the media used, which couldn't reach easily as many people. I think there was a certain attraction, and I will say a few more words about this, what made people think MOOCs is really something new. And what this diagram tries to argue for, well, like most things are not completely new. There are certain ancestors. I think the aspect that it was for free was also quite critical. So you could sign up for it and you didn't have first to think, will I spend, you know, marginal amounts of money, but maybe should I spend $50 of taking a course from the Open University? So these are some issues, and how it will continue in the future, I think that is still a little bit an open question. I mean, these major companies seem to be quite successful, and you don't have to be, so in the old days you had to be associated with particular efforts, like you had to work at the Open University. Now if you are a faculty member at the University of Helsinki or Aalto University, you can decide, I will offer a MOOC, whether the MOOC will be distributed by Coursera or supported by Coursera or by edX. This is a little bit a different story. So these are some elements which I think the time the technological environment of today facilitates this broader distribution. Who has ever heard the name Ivan Illich? Also a few. So Ivan Illich was, in my mind, an interesting person. He was a Jesuit priest, but was deeply concerned about schools and convivial tools. And he wrote a book called Deschooling Society in 1971. And what I find amazing, and you can find this article online if you are interested, I think it's worthwhile reading, that Illich in 1971 developed this architecture, which I try to graphically depict here, of learning webs, how he called it. And conceptually, I think it contains many ideas which now underlie MOOCs, but he did it basically 40 years before the technological substrate was available. So he talked about peer matching, about educational objects as open educational resources, skill exchange, that you can access knowledgeable domain experts, and so I find this really a remarkable achievement to envision the future. And I think Illich is worthwhile reading at least some of his ideas. So as the MOOCs came along, and maybe this is also a partial answer to your question, what were the promises? Well, you have courses from the top universities. So really first MOOC was from Stanford, and I guess Stanford has a reasonable reputation in the world. You learn from world-class professors. You watch high-quality lectures. Well, this could, obviously, there's a metric behind it. This could be debated. They also said you achieve mastery via interactive exercises. You collaborate with a global community of students, where the word collaborate we could critically evaluate. And an essential element that they are free at no costs. When MOOCs came along, this was really a very interesting phenomena. Like, I attend conferences occasionally, and like on, to name one, on computer-supported collaborative learning. And there are, wherever the conference take place, let's say 500 people participate. And then if there's any attention paid to such a conference in the popular press, it appears in a local newspaper in a little article. MOOCs, any respectable outlet was paying attention to the New York Times. The New York Times in 2012 declared the year of the MOOC. EdX made advertisements that it's the most important educational technology in 200 years. The president of Stanford that there is a tsunami coming. And even now you may say these are all, especially the first two, you know, were related to Coursera and EdX. But even Scientific America wrote articles that technology is remaking every aspect of education, bringing top-notch courses to the world poorest citizen and reshaping the way all students learn. So this was the hype around 2012. It has faded away a little bit. I don't know. Well, yeah, I mean, you may say Gutenberg's invention was also quite important and, yeah, even earlier, yeah. So, I wrote a little paper about the hype and underestimating of MOOCs, and here are some quotes of where people are coming from the total opposite end. And so Vardy, who is the editor of the communications of the ACM, which is a widely read journal for computer scientists, the absence of serious pedagogy in MOOCs is rather striking. Their essential features being short, unsophisticated video chunks interleaved with online quizzes and accompanied by social networking. If I had my wish, I would wave a wand and make MOOCs disappear, but I am afraid that we had let the genie out of the bottle. So, totally the opposite of the other opinions. Now, Sebastian Truhn was the founder of Udacity, and so, you know, if someone says something critical about the Catholic Church and the person is an atheist, people say, well, that's part of their worldview. If the Pope says something critical about the Catholic Church, it probably is a different story. And so Truhn, his remarks created a lot of attention because he was one of the founders of the MOOC movement. And he says, Udacity courses are often a lousy product. And then there were follow-up articles, the king of MOOCs abdicates the throne. And so I could have enumerated more things, but I wanted to show you that there was simultaneously hype. And at the other end, I labeled it underestimation. And I think if you are concerned about learning and education, maybe a challenge is to find a realistic assessment of MOOCs. And what we can see now, I mean, EdX and Coursera are offering courses worldwide, and I see no indication that they will go away in the next years. To return for one moment to another classification element. So I think MOOCs are particularly fitting. I know this group is concerned about e-learning. A question is, how would e-learning relate to these different bubbles here? So MOOCs is part of open online courses, but there are different approaches to it. There are quite a few for-profit courses in the United States, like the University of Phoenix, who has offered also online education. Sort of in the middle are open online learning environments, and at the bottom are open educational resources, where the resources are not kind of summarized or structured as courses, but you can go there and find out different things. So I would be interested, I mean, like, you are all coming here because you belong to this e-learning is a society. So is your understanding of e-learning related to this, or is it totally different? Is this a fair overview of e-learning efforts? Say it again. What would you? So the question was, or the comment was, the picture learns a non-open course. So, what would be an example of a non-open course?
The ones that viewers just provide their students with closed environments.
But the question then is whether they also use computational technologies. To be, what deserves then the e-learning attribute for what you say?
But they are like courses which are provided only for the students of the university.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I would say that the Open University is maybe somewhere in the middle of this. Like, you have to sign up and become a member. Maybe it's not as strong an association as you say, I am a student at Aalto. The Open University wants to meet the needs of people who are physically not in Helsinki, but want to have more structure. And so they are open. And the word open there is a little bit in the middle.
Getting back to this openness, I think it's deeply criticized also that our open actually the more platform providers are. You can't study at a university, you can't participate in the courses without giving privacy and the use of
Yeah, my understanding, not being expert there is, if we look at Wikipedia, then we mostly are readers, but there are associated pages where you can track the modifications and by whom they were made. And what you are saying, there is a possibility if I make a modification that I hide my identity, and I don't know that. Yeah. 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 Yeah, I think that probably is a fair, I guess I should repeat the comment, that the picture's missing sort of smaller groups which establish themselves in Facebook. This is sort of large, semi-organized at least environments. And I would agree with this, that this could be merged and added to this picture, to say, yeah, informal learning takes place not only in these environments, but incrementally more in the environments which you indicated. So here is, I think, one interesting question, maybe related to what I said at the very beginning of sort of the cultural embedding. embedded knowledge. And I think it's this is a very simple example, but there's a question: what is the value of local knowledge in a globalized world? So let's say some faculty member in the United States teaches a class about energy sustainability, and he uses the car the gas consumption of cars as an example to illustrate this. Now someone in Finland listens to this lecture, and if to understand the example in the United States, you use miles for distances and gallons for gas. I use Germany because I'm more familiar and wasn't sure how Finland is. You use kilometer for distance and liters for gas. So already that is sort of, I mean, you use different measurement types, and it may make local knowledge of the United States not easily understandable in Germany. I think the more interesting issue is car companies are required to, if they make ads for cars, to show the gas consumption. In the United States, you will read that a car goes 30 miles per gallon. So you choose a fixed amount of gas, a gallon, and you say, how far can you go? In Germany, you calculate this, or you determine this attribute. A car needs 7 liters per 100 kilometers. So you take a fixed distance and you say how much gas you need. How is it in Finland? Same as Germany. So, I mean, if I now, you know, would give you two numbers and say, well, which, and one is expressed in the German framework and one in the US framework, and you should compare which car is more favorable, it's not the easiest task. And this is a very trivial example, but I think the more abstract question is, if MOOCs have this global reach, what is the value of local knowledge? Or should we develop maybe MOOCs where MOOCs can be tailored by local experts to the particular local context? So there is a good MOOC which everyone likes, but maybe it should be added to by employing local context. So, having now said all of this, in some ways, I think what is a challenge is to reflect on, do we have opportunities to create richer landscapes of learning with respect to why do people learn, what do they learn, how do they learn, where do they learn, and here is a formal institution versus informal environments. When do they learn? In schools, in lifelong learning environments, with whom? Are we learning primarily as individuals or as communities? And who is a person who learns? A beginner, intermediate, student, or worker? So I said earlier I wanted to emphasize two differentiations. One is learning about versus learning to be. So learning about, very briefly described, is basically what MOOCs do. There is a teacher and you learn something about physics, about math. And it's focused on the accumulation of intellectual knowledge capital realized in a curriculum. Learning to be says, well, I want to be a mathematician, a physicist, or a designer. And the critical issue there, I think, is that we allow students to be in touch with communities who represent these learning to be environments. And in our center, we, for example, created an undergraduate research apprenticeship program where we particularly pursued this idea that undergraduates should have the same opportunities like PhD students, that they could be sort of apprentices, and then you are faced with the question, how do you scale this up? But again, saying here a versus relationship, I think the really interesting aspect is that to create interesting learning environment, we probably want to have both ways represented. The other distinction is learning when the answer is known. So the basic assumption in MOOCs is the teacher knows the answer, and the student who takes the MOOCs will learn what the teacher knows. We have been more interested in ideas learning when the answer is not known. So in some ways, even it is still a very instructionist setting here. I mean, I tell you something about my ideas, but I think more interesting would be to say, yeah, neither I nor any one of you particularly knows the answer, and we engage in a dialogue doing some collaborative knowledge constructions. And there are problems where, in some ways, the answer does not exist. So here is a claim, and you showed me earlier this sort of building which was designed for big classrooms, right? Which is just out there. And so I would be interested in your vote, whether you would vote for yes or no. So if we teach courses in residential universities for 300 people, I don't know whether that happens in Finland. Does that happen? That you have courses with 300 people? Okay. So my question is, if we teach a course at a university with 300 people, is this fundamentally different from a MOOCs course? Who would vote yes and who would vote no? So who is for yes? Fundamentally different. Who is for no? So what is the rationale for your answer? You say it is different.
Of 300 people, so you can hide behind each other's shoulders and not be active, but in a online learning or MOOC, so you need to be active as an independent student or participant. So that is the difference.
I'm for yes, because in the university setting, it's not just you are just in the lecture hall, but you can organize small group meetings where people meet face to face to discuss relevant things, to exercise on that, and you can provide face to face tutoring there, and that is something which much you cannot scale up that to 100,000. So that is one of the basic differences. And for the previous answer, I would comment that in an online setting, it's perfectly possible to stay silent and do nothing, still follow. Of course, it can be recorded that you do nothing. That's true. And when somebody is not present in a large lecture hall, then it's not so easy to note that. And so the teacher might not be aware so much that you are not active.
Well, of course, some things might be arguable because it's true that it depends on the pedagogical style. So you might try to, but to avoid the challenge that it means scalability in terms of having 300 people in the same room. But in my opinion, when you're dealing with such a big group, it's like the in terms of the institution, it's like you're dealing with a matter more of scalability. So in many cases, you're forced to follow more like standards are going to be there. There's going to be some type of assessment, so you make sure that there is some sort of homogeneous. So comparisons are going to be an important part. So it's not something that it has to be necessary per se, but it takes you into a direction or into a certain type of culture that it makes the whole learning style go into a more like instructional, behavioral, and usually quantitative measures might be more easy to adopt. I'm not saying that everyone follows that. You might try to break it and have small groups, and that will be, but in my opinion, that will be like trying to, you know, overcome the challenges of that environment. So other opinions?
So we could, you know, spend much more time on this. My opinion would go more into the no quarter. And if, let's say, the president of my university would ask me what I would suggest that we get rid of these very large classes because by their nature, they are mostly instructionist, at least in the presentation of the material. In my own teaching activities for many years, I have deeply believed in this notion of flipped classrooms, where the information as such people acquire beforehand, and then class time is used for discussions. This is not unproblematic. I mean, let's say in this setting, I would have sent the users slides, or maybe said I wrote an article, read this before, and then my presentation could have been much shorter, and we could have debated critical open issues. But it requires more engagement, and so I would argue if we do the large courses with MOOCs, maybe the university saves money, and I would invest this money in having more smaller classes, which can be much more interactive and so on. But these are really questions which universities try to think about. So with this we can say, and I think your answer went a little bit in this direction. What are core competencies of residential research-based universities which MOOCs may not be able to accomplish? And here are a number of attributes which I guess you emphasized, maybe emphasizing collaborative learning and communication skills, that if the people, even there are large numbers, they are together in the same physical settings, so they can communicate with each other. Maybe a more abstract criticism is, I believe that whether it's MOOCs or not, that we are educating our students too much that they solve problems. So students experience the teacher gives them a problem and they need to solve this problem. I think in the real world, we are much more concerned with framing problems, saying what is the problem? And we sometimes try our students get little exposure to articulating and saying, well, it is my problem and therefore I can decide whether I want to change the problem and not solve the problem which the teacher assigned to me. Well, that's good, and we should probably discuss in greater detail how you achieve this, and I agree with your second comment that I said before repeatedly by articulating sort of another opinion, it doesn't mean that it is always a replacement aspect. So problem solving obviously is still important, but I would say that problem framing, at least in many of the settings I was involved in, students have very few opportunities to engage in this activity. And so if the Finnish schools or universities do this, that I would say is a good thing. So we have also tried to incorporate this into our research, and if you are interested in any of these concepts, there are papers which we have written, my time is pretty much up, so I don't want to explain those things. I want to give you just one example, so you say, well, he talked a lot, but what have they really done? So this is an environment which we worked on for a long time. We call it the Envisionment Discovery Collaboratory. At the technological level, this table is a tabletop computing environment. So it's actually a computer, and it supports collaborative problem solving, particularly in urban planning tasks. So these people debate the development of a new bus route in the city of Boulder, where I live, and we brought together people from the city, urban planners, but also neighborhood representatives. We call this the action space. So people do actions in this space, and the vertical accompanying board we call the reflection space, and the problem solving, problem framing environment which we try to realize this is called reflection in action and reflection on action. Anyone is familiar with the book The Reflective Practitioner for Adonijan? So if you want to know more about this, you can ask these people. Another interesting challenge comes up. The number of MOOCs now available is really very large. And this is simultaneously an opportunity as well as a disadvantage. I mean, you can almost compare the MOOC space with, let's say, Amazon, who can offer many more books than a physical bookstore. And there was a theory behind it called the long tail. Again, some of you may have heard this or not, but the practical question is, you are interested in a self-directed learning activity in a very particular topic. How do you find out whether there is a MOOC available about this topic? This is like walking in a huge department store and trying to find something. And so eventually you find one course and you settle on this course, and then half a year later you notice, oh, there was actually a much better course which I should have taken instead of this one. So I think the MOOC space for idiosyncratic activities, Aalto University or any other university may not be able to offer a topic around this, but worldwide there may be enough interest for a particular topic. Let me briefly mention this. So when early on I had a quote that the idea was that MOOCs would be consumed or would provide opportunities for someone in Africa who would have access to the best courses in the world. I thought when I saw this data, this was actually quite interesting. And for those of you who are interested in lifelong learning, informal learning, what this shows that the largest group of people taking a MOOC are actually people who have already a master's degree. So MOOCs seem to serve this community well if they want to learn a little bit more what is of interest to them. And it also may make us reflect of what some people defend MOOCs, that it may be able to reduce the digital divide. That may be true or may not be true. So the big selling point and that it created so much interest was that MOOCs are free. And I like, and I actually had a bumper sticker on my door at a university, and the bumper sticker said, if you think education is expensive, try ignorance. Now, we all have to take economic perspectives into account, but I think it should not be the sole criteria. And one could argue that education is not free in any society. It's financed in different ways. And MOOCs made this impact by being free, but they were also lacking a business model. And here, the basic services are still for free, and you can go to any MOOCs and they probably fall into this category. But if you want to have anything under the second bullet, you pay for it. And so these are ways how MOOCs try to finance themselves, and because they have so many people taking it, it's still, they may still be able to create business models in the years to come which are sustainable. Then these are internal fights at universities, so maybe I should cast it in a Finnish context. So let's say you want to teach a course in artificial intelligence, and the university leadership has heard, well, there are very famous courses about artificial intelligence by people in Stanford or wherever, and why don't you take these courses? And so there were a number of real controversies that faculty members at smaller universities rejected this idea that a university made the decision to enrich their curriculum with these famous external courses, degrading, that were some of the arguments, faculty members to teaching assistants for these famous courses. There are interesting papers raising interesting issues, and I just wanted to mention that this is another controversy. So let me finish with one thought related maybe that we have been interested in design and in claims which I made earlier that schools, universities, education and learning are not God-given entities. So my argument is that the future of learning and education is not out there to be discovered, like Columbus discovered that there was America, but it has to be invented and designed. And then the questions are, which objectives do we have if we want to design this? What are our guiding principles? And I try to show something in the space surrounding MOOCs to not provide answers, but maybe raise some issues. And then the question is, who will do it? I mean, will the faculty at Aalto University say, yes, we have a stance and we pursue for good reasons that Finnish education should emphasize problem framing as a trademark for the following reasons? Or should it be determined by billionaires and venture capitalists in Silicon Valley? I think it's a fair assumption or criticism that MOOCs were able to generate this huge attention between because some people saw unique business opportunities. And so if we talk about this concept of learning in the digital age, which I chose for my original title, I would say my answer to this is that we should explore, nurture, and support rich landscapes of learning, which should include MOOCs, which should include e-learning, but which also should reflect on what are the core competencies of universities and how can we create an environment in which these different approaches complement each other in meaningful ways. Thank you.
Yeah, there's coffee available over there. I don't know, do we want to go on discussing over here or do we go and take a cup of coffee and then discuss in the smaller groups? How do you feel?
Totally up to what people like to do. Maybe we can, if someone has a burning question which is of interest to all, we can take 5 more minutes.
I have a burning insight. This is more like a comment. I was thinking about that I've seen the numbers that most of the especially those who complete the MOOCs, they come with quite high degrees before that they are have a master degree. And I've been thinking about it that it relates that the studying in a MOOC requires a lot of good skills of learning. You need the learning skills to survive the MOOC. You must be self-driven and able to do it. But then I was thinking this now related to something what Peter Dillenburg was saying at some point that who is a professor in Lausanne and runner himself, and he was saying that MOOC is a bit like a marathon. You go and run in a New York marathon or London with thousands of people together and it empowers you to run there with all these people. But combining these two notes makes me think that you just similar way as for running a marathon, you must practice a lot. So similar way to survive in the MOOC, you must have been practicing with the earlier studies, probably training in a more traditional way in a classroom or with a close group of people to survive the long distance then as a single event.
As you said, this is more a comment. A comment on your comment. I think what you basically said, I feel, is interesting in the following way. Historically, we had this model that people go to school where they learn, and then they leave school, and then they apply what they learned in school. It could also be an apprenticeship, like becoming a carpenter or something like this. They would apply for the rest of their lives what they learned in school or what they learned in a practical setting. And there is universal agreement that this is not a model where people change jobs so many times as a statistical number. So the alternative is that people started to reflect, well, how could, and there comes the preparation, which you indicated, how can we teach, how can we create an environment where people learn how to learn, or where people get experience exposures, how to learn on demand. So we all don't know something, and then are there rich enough environments where, as we need to know this, where we can learn on demand. And I think these are still open questions. What people do not disagree with the slogan that schools or students should in schools learn how to learn. What there is a lot of disagreement or lack of understanding, what does this really entail? What are these attributes that enable people to do so? And in America, there is a concept of soft skills, which are kind of contrasting learning facts, but you learn how to approach a problem, how do you, if you get into trouble, how do you get out of it? How do you search out people with whom you can communicate, or educational open resources? How do you create maybe Facebook communities where you discuss with people who have the same thing in their mind about this? So yeah, I mean, these are interesting questions, but questions which I think maybe, and again you may say in Finland, this is all different. In the United States is currently, if you followed this, the Secretary of Education is not a big friend of the people working in learning sciences. And I leave it at this, but just to show some of the controversies, how different people answer the question which you brought up in different ways. Any other questions, comments? Okay, thanks again.